Hi, this is Ali and you are watching the first video in the series, How Internet is Secured. The aim of this series is to build understanding of internet security on solid foundations. We'll build our understanding layer by layer from the ground up. This is the foundations video. Let's get started. Let's take a quick look at what this video contains. We start with the definition for secure communication, its historical evolution, latest techniques in the field, and concepts like digital signatures, certificate authorities, and role of trust in internet security ecosystem. Secure communication technologies evolved based on needs of the most powerful people, that is militaries, governments, and large organizations, to name a few. All three had a major stake in ensuring that the message they were sending or receiving were for intended audience only and no one else. Based on this, we can sum up the need for secure communication in three major goals. To ensure the message is understood by the intended recipient and no one else, even if intercepted by adversary. As per receiver's perspective, ensuring the message is indeed from the sender and not from someone pretending to be the sender. And lastly, ensuring that the contents of message have not been tampered with in transit. As a quick example, if you, as a king, receive a letter from a friendly neighboring country requesting reinforcement at location A, you would want to ensure that the enemy did not get to read the letter while the messenger who brought the letter was taking a nap on his way here. Secondly, you would want to ensure that the message indeed is from the neighboring country and not the enemy country trying to trick you into an ambush. For that, you might examine the king's seal or some other form of authentication. And lastly, you would want to ensure the contents of message have not been tampered with and reinforcements are indeed required at point A as stated in the message, not at point B where an ambush is planned on the way. How rulers and militaries tried to solve these issues over time? There were a bunch of technologies people came up with, from as simple as trusted messengers on horseback to skittily, which was a leather band wound around a cylinder, and the recipient needed an identical diameter of cylinder to understand the message. Then there was steganography, which means hiding messages in plain sight. Though this method survives even today in many forms, it could be as simple as message written on messenger's shaven head and hair allowed to grow before he is sent with the message. Then there are famous examples from movies where first letter of each word combined to form a message, and many other ways. Shifting characters was the first form of encoding developed in Roman times, and pre-digital encoding tech reached its peak in form of the Enigma machine used by Germans in World War II to communicate with their submarines. The problem with that tech was that one intercepted decoding machine meant death to the entire ecosystem. Then came along Cold War tech like data encryption standards, which was digital encoding scheme, followed by asymmetric keys or public key cryptography, which is the dominant form of encryption technology in use today. Let's take a closer look at public key cryptography, also known as asymmetric cryptography. Compared to earlier forms of encryption, it uses not one but two keys or a key pair for encoding. One is called public key and the other is called private key. They are both mathematically related, but their relationship is difficult, if not impossible, to decipher. In other words, you can't figure one given the other. Now please listen to the next three lines carefully as they are really important. The message is always encoded using public key of recipient. The message is always decoded using private key of recipient. Once encoded, the message can only be decoded using private key of recipient. Even the sender can't decode the encoded message. So what about the public or private keys of sender? Well, sender has his own key pair, but they are not necessary to encode the message. They are used for other operations, which we'll look into later on. Let's evaluate the advantages of public key cryptography. First one being the large key size of 1024 or 2048 bits compared to standard 128 or 256 bit encryption normally used in practice. The message is virtually impossible to break using brute force, even for a very resourceful adversary. With that kind of insurance, the message can be sent via open wire, letter, horseback, pigeon. It's entirely your choice. The biggest advantage, in my opinion, which makes it totally unique from all other encryption types, is that private key never leaves the receiver's possession or vault. So unlike other encryption types we looked at earlier, unless the receiver is careless enough to leak his private key from his personal possession, the communication would remain secure. Additionally, since this is a digital and mathematical encoding system, there are ways to digitally sign and hash the contents, so the receiver is able to authenticate the source and content of the message by digital means. This requires a technique called digital signatures. We'll evaluate in detail later on. Lastly, while receiver and senders each have keys of their own, they receive public keys of other party over the internet and need to trust that the key that they received actually belongs to the claimed party. We shall look at how it is ensured later on as well. The key pair system is not without its disadvantages, and in this case, the advantages are the main weaknesses as well. Starting off with the fact that this is a mathematics-based solution, and while there is no breach so far, doesn't mean someday a mad genius won't be able to find a way to derive private key from the public key. The large key size is both a blessing and a curse as well, as not only it means the encoding is really slow, the encoded message is too large in size for practical usage. If all communication done on internet is shifted to encoded form using asymmetric cryptography, it will slow everything down and transmission infrastructure or throughput would need a major upgrade. We shall see in later videos how these factors are mitigated in practical life. If you recall, we said that sender has its own pair of public and private keys, not necessary for encoding, but useful for other operations. Well, this is the key operation that they are used for, among others. The sender can use his private key to digitally sign the message, which essentially makes it authenticable by a recipient. Now, the signing algorithm uses two inputs, the private key of the sender and the hash of original message. Anyone with possession of sender's public key, which is public, can authenticate the signature by decoding it using sender's public key. If an intelligible output is produced, it means the signature indeed was created by the sender. Now, the decoded message also contains a hash of the original message that was encoded. Since receiver now has both the message and decoded signature containing the hash, he can rehash the received message using the same algorithm sender used and compare the generated hash with the decoded one to establish integrity of the message, which in English means message was not modified in transit. In the disadvantages slide, we mentioned that you receive public keys of other party over the internet and have to trust that they actually are the public keys of the other party. If you recall, the sender encodes using receiver's public key. If an attacker is able to switch the receiver's public key with his own, the sender would be tricked into encoding and transmitting messages, assuming secure communication with the receiver, but the attacker can decode all the messages using his own private key. This is a nightmare scenario indeed. And to ensure that you can reliably receive public key of receiver, there exists what is known as a public key infrastructure, or PKI for short, and something called certificate authorities. Let's look at the details. Anyone wanting to install a server to be able to receive secure messages need to go to a trusted source of identity management called certificate authorities. Depending on situation, they demand physical or virtual registration of receiver with their system. Once registered, the certificate authorities publish digital certificates, which are a trusted certificate containing receiver's identity and his public key. If you, the sender, want to securely communicate with a receiver, say the bank named XYZ Bank, you would receive a public key to encode with on their website, but then you would turn to a certificate authority to receive a certificate about the XYZ Bank and validate that the public key that you received actually belongs to XYZ Bank. But how do you know you are talking to the certificate authority and not the same attacker posing as XYZ Bank? Here's where the entirety of public key infrastructure comes into play. Without going into too much details in Foundation's video, the browsers do the validation for you. The entire chain of trust starts with the browser you are using, and you should always use a trusted browser. Trusted browsers have embedded within their software at installation time a list of trusted certificate authorities, along with their public keys. Browsers blindly trust certificate authorities in that list, just like you trust yourself. This list is called root certificate authority. The browsers, on your behalf, request certificates from certificate authorities and verify that issuer of certificate, that is the certificate authority itself, is the one in your root CA list. The problem is that to secure their own private key, the root certificate authorities rarely issue certificates for end users like the XYZ bank. They rely on intermediate certificate authorities to register and issue certificates on their behalf. The intermediate certificate authorities are, however, signed using the private key of a root CA. It's the browser's job to ensure that the chain of validation ends up to a root CA in its built-in list. Did we mention you need to trust the browser for secure communication? Well, the entire ecosystem is built on trust, and trust is both the friend and the enemy here. At minimum, as a normal user, you trust the browser, and the browser trusts the certificate authorities that are part of its inbuilt list. And they in turn trust their intermediate certificate authorities to issue certificates after careful validation at registration time. Thing is, even certificate authorities can be compromised and issue fake certificates. But this is very carefully watched and incidents are handful and very rare. That is why the ecosystem hasn't collapsed yet and secure communication is thriving. A quick look at the chain of trust in slightly more detail. Say you are trying to communicate with your XYZ bank website, you would trust your browser to initiate communication, and you, not the browser, would also trust the certificate authority that issues certificate for your bank website. It means you would trust that CA did its due diligence, that the entity registering itself in its office is indeed the bank and not someone pretending to be the bank. That is what I mean by trusting the certificate authority by you and not the browser, even if you don't know this. Now your browser would obtain the public key from the bank website and turn to certificate authority to issue a certificate for that website. Once it has the certificate, the public keys can be matched and validated, but then the browser validates the CA itself by trying to either match its public key in its root CA database or trying to obtain certificates for CA by a higher ranking CA and matching its public key with the certificate. The process continues until the browser is able to match the public key of issuing CA with the one in its root CA list. At this stage, the chain of trust is complete and secure communication can begin. You now have the receiver's public key with a reasonable degree of trust that it is indeed the receiver's public key. You can now send encoded messages to receiver. But does all communication take place using receiver's public key? After all, we discussed it won't be practical with the real-world constraints. Here is where protocols like HTTPS come into play to make communication both secure and practical. We shall look into HTTPS in good detail in our next video. Right, thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned something useful today. If you liked the content, please do like and subscribe to be notified of new content in my channel. Thank you.